While there was much fanfare and attention given to the July 3rd launch of two Type 055 guided missile destroyers at the Dalian Shipbuilding Industry Company, DISC shipyard in Dalian, very little mention has been made of the many other warships that the plan has launched or commissioned since the beginning of the year. Although the Type 055 DDG is the plan's most powerful service combatant and the largest such vessel constructed by an Asian nation since World War II, they are one component in a steadily growing naval force structure. While the addition of three Type 055 DDGs this year, added to the first vessel in class, which rolled into the water from Dalian just over a year ago in June of 2017, showcasing China's growing capability not only in producing powerful and modern warships, they also illustrate the maturity and stunning capacity of the Chinese shipbuilding industry. This industry has launched and or commissioned 15 modern warships in just the first 7 months of 2018. As it is mentioned before, three vessels have been the newest and most powerful surface warfare vessels in the Chinese arsenal, the Type 055 DDG. Since 2017, China has launched a total of four vessels in class. The fifth and sixth vessels are already in varying stages of construction. Although initial reports had suggested that a total of six vessels had been ordered, it has been hinted that this number has been increased to eight. This number will most likely grow to at least 12 vessels by 2025, when the plan will be looking to expand its aircraft carrier program with the introduction of at least one carrier of the Type 002 class. Three brand new Type 052D destroyers also appeared in the images made at the DISC shipyard in Dalian. The Type 052D is a powerful guided missile destroyer in its own right, rivaling the U.S. Navy Arleigh Burke-class DDG. China launched the first Type 052D, the Kunming DDG-172, in 2014. There are currently nine ships of the class in service, two undergoing sea trials, and a further two being fitted out. Three Type 052 DDGs have been commissioned in the first half of this year. Although original rumors had hinted at 16 vessels being ordered, some inside sources now claim that the number has been increased significantly. It would seem reasonable that a total of 18 to 26 vessels may end up being built, depending upon how ambitious the planned aircraft carrier program becomes. From 2014 to present, the Chinese shipbuilding turned out 14 Type 054A class guided missile frigates, total of 32 of all variants, and no less than 20 Type 056A class corvettes, total of 42 in class of all variants, over the same period of time. Their small size equates to limited firepower and shorter range, but they are well suited to serve as picket ships and screening forces to task forces fielding larger and more powerful vessels when those fleets are operating within close range of home ports and naval facilities. Type 056A class corvettes will likely be employed to patrol China's coasts, the maritime territories within China's EEZ, as well as the island archipelagos of the Paracel and Spratly Islands. Type 054A and Type 054A class frigates could be deployed for the operations overseas, for example in the Gulf of Aden. The most capable nuclear attack submarine, SSN, in service with the plan is a Type 093B. It is not known how many Type 093B SSNs are currently in service, but most analysts, including those at the U.S. Office of Naval Intelligence, put the number at six. Of greater interest is a newer SSN that is either currently being fitted out or is undergoing sea trials later this year, the Type 095. It is an SSN but reportedly has sizable VLS, 12 to 16 cells, which can fire a multitude of planned missiles including anti-ship cruise missiles, ASCM, and land attack cruise missiles, LACM. The Type 094 Jin-class nuclear ballistic missile submarine has also undergone a noticeable transformation, resulting in what has been renamed the Type 094A. Improvements to the new variant include a larger VLS aft of the conning tower, a more streamlined shape which produces less noise and caviation while submerged, likely greater speed submerged, and a new ballistic missile armament. The final Type 071 class landing platform, Dock LPD of the original order of six vessels, at the Hudong Zhanghua shipyard on January 20th of this year. The fifth vessel was launched just 7 months prior. It remains unknown if the plan will decide to order additional LPDs of this class, or will concentrate instead on the larger Type 075 LHDs, currently under construction at the same shipyard, which constructed all six Type 071 LPDs. It is logical to conclude that China may decide to build additional Type 071 LPDs, but this will depend perhaps on how long it will take to construct, launch, and commission the first of the new class of landing helicopter docks, LHDs. With six LPDs in service, after the final two vessels are finally commissioned, the plan will always have at least two of them ready to deploy as the backbone of a small amphibious-ready group, ARG. A planned ARG would likely consist of at least one Type 071 LPD, two Type 072 LSTs, and a surface warfare escort of a mix of DDGs and FFGs. These smaller amphibious warfare vessels lack the size and capability of bringing their own aviation strike element with them. It is clear that a larger amphibious warfare platform is required for the plan in the immediate future. If the time it took China to design, build, launch, and fit out its first indigenous aircraft carrier is an indicator, we are likely looking at the first Type 075 to be launched sometime in 2020. China signaled to the world that it fully intended to field aircraft carrier battle groups, CBG, in the near future when it launched the first Type 901 fast combat support ship in December of 2015. The first vessel in this class, Hulun Hu, hull number 965, commissioned in September of 2017. These massive underway replenishment ships are designed to be able to meet the logistic needs of fast-moving carrier battles and strait groups. The plan also operates the Type 903 and Type 903A class fleet replenishment vehicles. The Type 903 was greatly improved and took on the designation Type 903A, with the first two examples commissioned in the summer of 2013. There are six Type 903A replenishment ships on active service, and a seventh currently in an advanced state of construction. Fleet replenishment vessels are a vital component of a blue water navy. They allow fleet task forces, carrier battle groups, and amphibious-ready groups to engage in complex missions thousands of miles from home ports and over extended periods of duration. These vessels are indispensable to aircraft carrier battle groups engaged in long deployments. The big picture, Plan 2025, the rapid pace of warship construction by China, is impressive from an engineering and manufacturing standpoint, but of greater interest is an understanding of the motivation behind such an ambitious program. In many ways, China is engaged in a concentrated effort to redefine the economic realities that have established the way the world exchanges goods and services and distributes the product of human endeavors globally. The new Silk Road Maritime Silk Road project seeks to once again make China the center of the economic world. China is already the largest economy in the world in terms of economic production and is on pace to usurp the US as the world's largest economic consumer as well. Continued growth and prosperity depend upon cheap and efficient movement of energy resources and raw materials to China and the cheap and efficient movement of finished goods from China. The overwhelming majority of these influxes and outflows transit the international waterways of the world. Continued prosperity and stability depend upon the security of these maritime lanes of trade. In strategic terms, these naval lines of communication must remain open. In times of strife and natural or man-made disaster, China must have the capacity to secure these lines of communication and to keep them open. Although China has been the first and most determined nation to move in this direction, it is not alone. As China moves to build a new logistics system that aims to redirect the movement of information, energy, and economic goods that competes with the current established system dominated by the United States. The United States and its allies are determined to maintain the status quo. Some of these allies, such as India, are allies of necessity and are also attempting to maintain their independence. China has accepted the wisdom of long-standing naval strategy and has proven the most decisive in embracing these centuries-old concepts. If China does not alter its current building projects by increasing or reducing orders, the plan will still be a highly transformed fighting force by 2025. The year 2025 will prove to be a milestone for the plan for many reasons. By 2025, China will likely be declaring its first Type 002 class aircraft carrier operational. The Type 002 will be an EMALS-assisted catabar-capable carrier that may likely be nuclear-powered. At the same time, two other aircraft carriers, although recognized as developmental steps along the way to the Type 002, will also be in service. Based on the pace of pilot training and the procurement of aircraft over the past decade, the plan will have at least one more regiment of carrier strike aircraft in service, bringing the total to two regiments. China is already seeking to develop and field the carrier-borne strike aircraft superior to the J-15, even though many of the J-15's shortcomings will be rectified by improved catabar system of the new Type 002 carrier. The plan will be able to transport an enlarged PLA Marine Corps to battle in its first amphibious-ready group, albeit with limited capabilities. The first Type 075 LHD will be undergoing operational training to test the capabilities of the vessel and familiarize sailors, marine, and airmen with amphibious and air assault missions from such a complex and powerful platform. There will be 6 Type 071 LPDs in service, as well as 15 Type 072 LSTs. The majority of an additional 17 Type 072 LSTs of an earlier design will still be in service. The recently expanded PLAMC, numbering approximately 100,000 men, a fivefold increase from 2017, will finally have the modern amphibious sea lift capacity that it currently lacks. PLAMC Marines will serve in duties deployed at sea and stationed at a growing number of Chinese sovereign island bases or abroad at naval bases in foreign countries such as Pakistan and Djibouti. By 2025, the plan will have a robust naval logistics arm available to support naval operations across the length and breadth of maritime Silk Road. 2 Type 091 fast combat support ships and 9 Type 903A replenishment ships will be available at a minimum. 4 Type 904 general stores issue vessels are currently in service to resupply island garrisons and offshore bases. This number may increase in the intervening years. The plan has increasingly invested in high-tech, powerful, and flexible conventional warships that are also cost-effective when compared to their new designs pursued by the U.S. Navy. Even the Type 002 aircraft carrier is a conservative design with a limited mission foreseen for it, one which will minimize its weakness and make use of its strengths. It is telling that China has built the largest surface warfare ship since the U.S. commissioned the last Ticonderoga-class cruiser Port Royal CG-93 in 1994. The U.S. has no plans to replace the 22 Ticonderoga-class cruisers anytime soon, nor is there a replacement design to consider. The Gerald R. Ford class CVN-78 has proven to be a costly and disappointing investment so far. It will use the F-35 JSF and F-18 Super Hornet, which lacks a range, to be a threat to peer adversaries. The Zumwalt class DDG is a dead-end failure, and the troubled LSC program has proven to be less capable than the traditional multipurpose frigate designs of other major navies. While the U.S. has wasted its great wealth on failed designs, whose sole aim is to earn profits for a defense industry, more interested in profit-generating waste than in producing weapon systems that balance capability, efficiency, and cost-effectiveness, China has done something quite different. China has produced cutting-edge warships and aircraft for its navy that are largely improvements upon proven design and technology. China has made major progress in missile technology, surpassing the U.S. in many respects. It has also reaped rewards from years of investment in research and development of advanced radar and even photon detection technologies. There is no doubt that China has gotten far more return on its investment in terms of its defense industry in comparison to the United States. For the military defense complex that rules the United States, the goal is profit, not the defense and security of the nation. From 2001 to the present, the United States military has morphed into a force obsessed with counterinsurgency and occupation, leaving it woefully unprepared for a conventional conflict with peer adversaries such as Russia or China. The US Navy has transformed into a global police force, meant to be used as a stick to bludgeon any small nation that dares to disobey the dictates of the United States. Its powerful aircraft carrier strike group, CSG, lack the air wing capable of striking the shores of powerful adversaries, rendering these great symbols of US power impotent against any capable foe in a major conflict. The US Navy is powerless to change the strategic situation in the South China Sea through military means, as China has already crossed the Rubicon. Imperial hubris, corruption, and arrogance have done greater damage to the US military than any foreign adversary has over the past 17 years. The year 2025 will witness a plan in ascent and a US Navy in decline. This is not to say that the US Navy will not still be the preeminent naval power globally, but it will continue to be mirrored in lack of strategic direction, focus, and budgetary crisis. The plan will be guided by a clear strategic focus, increasing capabilities, and a robust shipbuilding and weapons acquisition program. There is no doubt that the plan will emerge as the second most powerful navy in the world and will exert significant influence in both military and geostrategic terms.